to attending these 4 days of trainings. If you were 45 miles away from the college, you would get housing, and if not, you would have to drive back and forth every day for 4 days. So six of us went. Those who couldn't go the first batch, we went to them. So when we got back, we formed a team. There's a team of ESL faculty, two ESL faculty, and a counselor. Three of them have a special project that I want to go back home and read to see what the results are, because they just finished it last semester. So they came back in August, started their project in September, to see how it worked, the intervention by the counselor coming into the ESL classroom. How did it change?
So we keep building on the same thing. We had had, college had done this before, and got maybe 20, so then we went from 20 to 40, and then six more. So now there's 66 student faculty members that are trained in this process about self-awareness for students, how to motivate them to be to not be dependent on us, and to make wise choices, and to take personal responsibility for their actions, both positive and negative. And that really is transformative. It makes a real big difference in their classroom experience.
And you'll see that when I go through the list of some of the activities they'll do, because I'm gonna bring it back now to the hybrid class. And my students on a weekly basis have to do a self-reflection. Self-reflection is, what did I do right this week? What didn't I do right? How am I doing in this class? What do I need to change to pass this class? Again, it's they're taking self-control over what needs to be done, succeeding in the course.
And that's woven into the content. So the content of the course is, it's not like, oh, this is going to be, let's feel good about ourselves.
No. It's
rigorous content.
If the reading skills are still there, it's just the class is very different. The theme has been citizens of the interlocking world, because they go, we talk about reading skills, main idea, vocabulary and context, inference, critical thinking, connotation, denotation, all the reading skills you could think of. However, how it's presented, the themes, the reading selections that are brought in, is what makes it unique. They go reading about San Jose, California, problems in their own little neighborhood, they go national, and they go international. So by the time they may not leave their seats in the semester, but the computer's the most powerful tool I have in the classroom. They travel the world. And by the time they're done, they go, oh my God, I read so much and I know about this. I never thought I'd be talking about this.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah, sure.
So when the students are coming in, are they automatically required to have a placement test if they haven't completed any college courses?
Yes, so they are. They have to do a placement and they have to do orientation. Before it was recommended, now it's mandated. So it really makes a big difference, because some of these ideas that you're saying now are woven into that process. So a student, so it becomes the same narrative at different points and it just expands. So you hear a little bit about it during assessment, you hear a little about it during orientation, you hear more when a counselor, and then you hear a lot about it in class, and then you hear about it again from the counselor, so that it's again coming sort of full circle from when you started.
And has it always been mandatory, or was
it's just actually, it just happened 2 years ago.
Because see, that's the issue we find.
Students don't do optional.
Yeah, they don't. And that's, I'm in a community college. So
yes.
And what state?
Massachusetts.
Okay.
And that's the constant conversation that we have, is that students, that's what we say, students don't do mandatory, right. Optional.
Optional. Yeah.
They need mandatory, like it's this or the highway, basically. You know, you have to come to this for that very reason, so that you're constantly hearing that same narrative every step of the process.
But I'll tell you how, sort of that bridge of what we got through, so it's mandatory, but we still don't kind of enforce that piece of it. What made a big difference wasn't us saying it's mandatory. What made a big difference was all of us talking and saying, this is what you should do. Because the student also, when you come in, you don't know that you're not supposed to do this. So we say, okay, this is what it is. And so how we did that to make it easier is every time we have an assessment, we have an orientation. So it's part of the same. So when the person signs you up for assessment, you say, oh yeah, and your orientation is da-da-da. And then they do it, because it just becomes part of the process.
Right.
And when they talk to Celia in her classroom, she says, oh, did you go to orientation? See, so when people start saying it, then it becomes this process, and it's something like we have the assessment and orientation in the same room all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So it becomes, oh yeah, I know where it is. You know,
right.
It becomes part of the memory of the college to then do these things. And this part didn't cost any money. It's just reorganizing and having the passion to do this.
Okay, so again, we go from local, national, international issue topics and concerns. most of the themes are about legal and illegal immigration, global warming, higher education, organization, contagious disease, famine, human trafficking, wars, you name it. We read about it. Even we're doing topic, main idea, vocabulary, context. It's all in there. And because the class is hybrid, I get to see them in the classroom on Tuesdays when I front load the skills, but on Thursdays they have reading assignments to do. So the textbook also has a lot of controversial topics. So they're reading every day. Even the ones who tell me the first day is, I hate to read, by the time they leave, 12 weeks later, they love to read. And many of them confess, I have never read a book complete from cover to cover until I came to this course. So some, this is some of the format that I have. We meet on Tuesdays in the classroom. Thursday, the work is posted online. Skills are mainly from loaded on Tuesdays, practice skills on Thursday. Sometimes I do the flip classroom model where they have to read about the skill first. Then when they come back next class session, they have to teach each other what the topic was, what the skill was. I'm trying to do it more often, but it takes some preparation on their behalf. Before the class starts, week or two before, even though it starts a month later, I send them a welcome letter. And that welcome letter explains to them what the class is all about, reminding them, hybrid, one day in the classroom, one day online. I also have a welcome video that I recorded myself, and more or less similar to the content of the letter, but it's this time is set to them. So again, addressing all the learning modalities. Students receive weekly emails from me is, you're doing great, thanks for posting, or I noticed you haven't posted your assignment. Are you doing okay? And when students don't log in for 48 hours or longer, they get from me what I call the wellness email, the wellness check. It's like, hey, I noticed you haven't done this. Is there any way? Do you want to meet with me? I'm in my office. Mm-hmm. Or meet with the in-class tutor, because that's someone else that helps in that classroom. Activities in the class, reading selections and comprehension questions, both in the classroom and online. The comprehension questions, I break them up by question one, question two, online. So they're not overwhelmed if they have it has 8 or 10 questions. Question one, response. Question two, response. So I break it down for them to avoid that anxiety that it can take over. Weekly forums, everyone has to post. And most of the times they have to do a peer comment. That's my interaction, as they would in the classroom, that's how they do it online. Weekly student self-reflections, like I mentioned, they're taking control. It's, I'm doing well, I'm not doing well, I did my homework, I didn't do my homework. I learned that through the on-course. Quizzes, I try to keep quizzes to a minimum of 5 to 10 questions online. In the classroom, it can be longer. A mock midterms, a mock final exams are posted online for them to see what the actual one will be, but the final exams and the midterms are always given in the classroom. Students' feedback at the end of the semester, what has been more productive for them, what hasn't. What do they think I should change for the next group? Again, allowing them to tell me where I can change to make it better for the next group. It's always about the students. It's not about me, it's about them. How are they gonna get to the next level? My goal is for them to get to English 1A and transfer. I have some students who finished their master programs. I have some of my former developmental students in the cyber course. She's a board of trustees at another district. So again, they can do it. They just need to find the right environment to get through. I want to share with you some of the recent statistics. Like I mentioned, I moved from a 16-week hybrid to a late start hybrid. And these are the statistics of the last two semesters. This is after census. Census is after the third week, right? So there were 24 students enrolled. They all stayed. They wouldn't go away. 20 passed. It's an 83%. This last semester, we just finished in December, 20 of them were at census day, 20 of them remain, 16 of them passed. The class offers a common board graded final. These four didn't pass because they missed the last 3 weeks of school and I could not track them down. It was close to the holiday season and I found out that the grapevine, they all had gotten jobs. So. Helping a family is more important at this point in their life an education. But I send them emails. I'm offering the class again in the spring. just sign up, let's pick up where you we left off. I want to share with you that I have, through the help of Title V, Metas Grant, through basic skills, my students have set, I have 20 textbooks that I lend out to my students. My students do not purchase textbooks. I have borrowed computers that the students can check out for the semester. So they don't need to own a computer to do the hybrid course. We have a classroom, we have labs on campus. They can also come to do it. I said, come on into the reading and writing center. Tutors are there available. They can help you, the computers are there. You don't need anything. We use the learning platform is Moodle. There's an app for them to use. They taught each other. One class meeting was set. They were teaching each other how to download it to their smartphones. I mean, it's there. All I'm trying to do is up and out.
So what's the normal passing rate?
It's about 70. Yeah. So about 70.
So it's significantly higher.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
Okay, so this is a little bit of some of the accomplishments. We piloted in 2003 as a long hybrid, you know, one day a week for 16 weeks. Late start hybrid started in 2014. Our next level after 301 is Reading 101. That course was also piloted as in summer 2014 as a hybrid for the Summer Bridge program. And then this last summer, it was offered for the general college students. Again, hybrid, they would meet 2 days with me in the classroom and 2 days online because this summer is shorter, it was six weeks. Now starting spring 2016, we went from one hybrid section to two hybrid sections. Now we're gonna have three hybrid sections, but I'm just teaching two of them. Someone else who's never taught hybrid is going to teach it. We'll see how that one goes. And there is collaboration with the counselors because we're trying to get guided classes offered near at the same time where these courses are being offered so they can take college orientation or career planning guidance class at the same time as they're taking.
And again, that's just organizational. It's not going to be any expense. We teach those courses already.
So again, it's that partnership, that collaboration that I have with the counselors. We started off several years ago. Basic Skills Initiative was paying for in-class tutor that has been institutionalized. The college is paying the cost now. So every Tuesday, I have a tutor for my Reading 301 class. Every Thursday, I have an in-class tutor for an hour and a half. And while I'm working with a large group, he is working with the ones who are a little slower or a little bit behind. We have 20 textbooks that have been purchased. We're going to be purchasing 100 dictionaries to check out to the students, and that is through funding from the Basic Skills Grant. So this brings us to the end of our presentation. But I want Roland, if you can expand a little bit more about the Summer Bridge.
Sure. So Summer Bridge is kind of the same model that we're talking about, where it's mandatory. So we have a Summer Bridge program that takes students that are two levels before math, college level math or English, and then they're eligible for the program. And this came out of our Title V grant, which really just organizes it. Because then the other piece that we did is just move our schedule, existing faculty and existing classes, to this model. So there's a counseling class, there's an instructional class, then there's a counseling class, and there's an activity on Fridays. So that part wasn't any more money. And then the college then decided that they would pay for the books, pay for transportation, and pay for food. So when we tell the parents, you know, the package, it's an easy sell. It really is, because we say, this is how you go from here to here. And then we tell them the real facts, which is, if students who don't go with this model end up taking 5 to 6 years here at the community college. And that's the reality of it. And we know that some of the students are going to need additional instruction to get to that college level. But as a parent, sometimes a parent doesn't even understand what that is. So with this program, we're able to bring them in, talk to the parents, talk to the students, then talk about, you know, the responsibility, wise choices, what do you want to do? You have this opportunity, and it's great if you want to do it, but we just want to make sure that you know that this is going to make a difference. And I'll tell you, our completion rate was 100%, and our persistent rate was about 95%.
So
it's also our middle. No. Well, so, I mean, really, it works. Mm-hmm. The thing is, how, you know, the challenge is going to be, how do we take it from 60 to 80 students to, like, hundreds of students? But the model is very effective. And when we hear from our students, they say the same things that they're talking about Celia. You teach sometimes in the meet reading class, and they'll say, wow, without this program, I would have known. And now I get it. I understand that I could be here 2 extra years if I don't take, you know, the class, da-da-da-da-da. And we don't want them to take the math and the English class, but to only one or the other. The point is to get a student started early on and to understand, you know, what courses they need to get to their goal.
Putting the awareness in front of them,
exactly,
and the onus of, okay, here's what I need to complete. Mm-hmm. I completed the following. This is what's left. I think that's huge.
Absolutely.
At least at my institution, I find that the students are so heavily dependent on the counselor to tell them what to take. To where, if for whatever reason the counselor's not there that day, or they can't get in touch with them, that could be the difference sometimes between them staying or going.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And because they have no idea. Yeah.
So that's where we went from that passive, you know, sort of advisement model to this more active one where the student is really being self-directed to a degree, but then also has these tools and these wonderful resources that are being woven through from the orientation and assessment all the way through the classroom. And it really makes a big difference.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's a pretty high retention rate. You're talking about math is not fun. I mean, reading's more fun, but math. And you know, the student, we're talking about, by and large, American-born students.
Mm-hmm.
Or people who've been in for a long period of time. So it's not, I mean, I think there's some language acquisition questions, but that's not really it. It's the instruction that they have. You know, it's not like, oh, I'm from somewhere else, so I'm, no, that's not it. It's the instruction that they've had previously to come to. That's really the heart of the matter is. And when parents hear this, and I had one parent come to talk to me and said, you know, this is such a great use of our tax money. Why aren't we doing this for everybody? Because he said, you know, it's not that much money, but it makes a big difference if you don't have to worry about book, food, and transportation.
And they get into the routine, because my summer 2014 students, I still see them. It was a cohort of 15 so. And they're still on campus. They come by, and if they're stuck, they have a problem with something, they feel comfortable coming in and say, can you help me with this? And if I don't know the answer, I will certainly pick up the phone and make sure I find the right answer for them, or whoever knows that right answer, but then make a connection. Otherwise, if they're just parachuted in with this previous experience with the counselor, this is this person, that, they get lost. We all know that ourselves. Because either we got lost along the way when we were going to college and we took some time off, or our children have done that. So,
and there's a reason why the student isn't doing well, or isn't at that college level, and it's not just on the student.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So they come with an experience already, and so we have to then, they come with strengths, and we have to find those strengths and then build upon those.
I think too, you remove the barriers that they're sometimes bogged down by. So once the barriers are removed, the student then feels comfortable with you to say, here are my issues, I need help with the following things, and then they're allowed to be successful.
Exactly. That's a great point. They're allowed to be successful sometimes.
Yeah.
They don't feel like they're empowered for the success.
Yeah, I think they don't. I mean, a lot of students, we deal with first generations of just walking in.
Yeah, that's what 70%
of
our students.
They're already, like, you know, frightened to be there. And then it's like, I got to get books. I don't have the money for books. I don't know how I'm going to get there today because my ride, you know, canceled everything. So when all those things are removed, all you have to do is just focus on this. And you, like you said, you can find those strengths within that person.
Yeah.
And then they will come back to you because now you've made that connection. And
you're right. You know, I think of
so
the semester, I just showed you the December one, which is the second level. I'm teaching the third level coming up in spring. And I have from that cohort, there was 20 of them. 10 of them have registered for the next class with me. And there's one particularly young lady, Destiny. She's a security guard from 11 o'clock at night to 7 in the morning. My class is at 9:15. She comes in half asleep, but she comes in. She wants to get the skills so she can work online on Thursday. She's my inspiration of me making sure I'm there on time, that I'm there for her after class.